Part two of my Power Rangers 2017 review. How did they do the film? When I first watched the trailers, I was thinking this: there would be no risk, as it could be Day of the Dumpster, which is rated one after Saban took back the show in a poll. Goldar would be in the intro. They get the Zords. They get all that kind of pilot stuff. It worked to start the show. It worked to start this movie franchise. Risk. They completely redid the characters, changed the races, so that they're basically completely different characters other than the names. Lionsgate Tommy Oliver is the new kid. Everyone, including David Yost at New York Comic Con, praised R.J. Seiler, and they were right. His character reminds me of the episode where the Power Rangers meet the girl who is Death, the Mighty Morphin Power Ranger episode, the different drum. Captain Logan of the Evolution claimed that Jason was anti-authority. I didn't really see a reason for it, albeit him and Brother Media's Mike Stoklasa mentioned this as well. Jason has a big moment as he grows into being a leader, as opposed to starting with it at the beginning of the show. All the stuff I like is that they set up everything, opposed to like starting off with it. It's a good origin story. A bit Batman Begins, like, even though it's not that dark, not that well explained. It's a Begins approach. The Rangers learn to fight. They don't know the pilot, and which is very weird because it doesn't really make any sense how they would beat Goldar, but whatever. Zordon isn't perfect. Kimberly's a borderline villain. Jason is a martial artist, which is given the Trini for one scene, and sort of forgotten. Did you learn the combat, though? He has a football background, which is fairly negligible. Forming the Zords could have made the football background a little bit more better. Jason isn't the face of the franchise. He is the popular kid at school, much like Kimberly. It's unlike a show where he's just a martial arts student, school student, etc. Kimberly sort of takes Zack and Tommy's spot for the big friendship role with Jason, and possibly more, as seen in the trailers. His emphasis on leadership abilities and relationship with Zordon is a highlight, and the moment when Billy's nearly killed off in the franchise, Zordon steps down, giving Jason the Red Ranger role and Billy powers and Jason leadership, a highlight of the film. A noticeable thing in the trailers was a black joke of R.J. Seiler's character. R.J. Seiler's character begins not as a great fighter and is bullied, but really amps it up later on because of his OCD personality. They could have added R.J. Seiler and Trini to mix together how they could both be the greatest martial artists in the show. Again, for the movie, Billy Jason and possibly Kimberly were the emphasis. There was a big moment with him, as I mentioned before. And since there wasn't much for the Rangers to do in the Zord sequence, I would have liked Billy to use his OCD to get more immersed into the Zords. Speaking of the black joke, there was a major controversy over the Zack and Trini characters' casting. Trini does do a kung fu sequence with Kimberly, which I hoped would be more Krispy Kreme product placement. Not to mention that Trini did the kata in the beginning, and hopefully there will be more later. Maybe it was deleted from the new scenes. I still sort of find her character an afterthought, although logically her sexual orientation is unclear and not in depth. My heart feels like it was an attempt to emphasize Trini as the diverse female of the group, opposed to the all-American Sweet Valley popular girl Kimberly's was in the movie. She's been known as an outsider by many. She was the sixth ranger, according to Jason, in the WinterCon panel. Austin John, sorry. She does an Eastern martial arts pose on the top of a mountain, as I mentioned before. Her discussion about sexual orientation brings about a 2010s, 20s discussion about diversity, even though it's even unclear what her race is. Something interesting that they could do is that they could emphasize how she's identified with Asian in later films or original cuts, but was later cut after audiences got upset about it. much like with Ghost in the Shell recently. Maybe they'll write it more in depth after a fan, audience, and critical backlash. I don't know if there's anything I have to add about Zack, so I'm just going to copy and paste my thoughts on Zack from my previous article here. Same with Kimberly. There's a lot I have to say about the Zack in Power Rangers 2017 subject before we go into social justice warrior territory. Hong Kong stars are treated with a lot of esteem. There's not a lot of marketing for Donnie Yen in the U.S. Many action films are when they are marketed. Recently, post-2000s, there's a lot of comedic roles for that, such as that of John Cho and the guy from The Hangover. Recently, there's a Asian-American family sitcom on ABC. Hero from Heroes is portrayed as an immigrant. Zack, I hope, from the Power Rangers movie will make Asian Americans proud. Him acting with the others instead of with his mother was a bit of a contrast. He's the wacky one, but he didn't get like Jason annoying by like milking a bull or something, or John Troller, the Hangover guy, amount of annoying. He actually was pretty cool. Someone you like to hang out with, like Zack in the TV show. In contrast, I didn't really get the city vibe from Walter Emmanuel Jones. And he doesn't really start off as Jason's best friend. They even come to blows, which may be a controversial change from the original mythos, some people may consider. Not everything has to be exactly the same, though, and other changes may happen later.
Kimberly in Power Rangers 2017. I was a big fan of her in the original series. Originally watching the show, you think of her as a valley, stuck-up kid. However, rewatching the show, you notice things. She befriends a nerd, an Asian female nerd, and an African-American. She gets good grades, she's not racist, she doesn't judge. She does dirty stuff like creating a float, without caring about her nails. She knows gymnastics and, of course, martial arts. She cares about recycling. She gets good grades. I don't know how many times I said that. She flies a plane. She's knowledgeable. She's not an idiot. Not like other popular girl stereotypes. 2017 Kimberly was written as a new Kimberly should be. Popular girl beats up people, demonstrate the horrors of being a popular girl. I believe the cutting people out of photos, etc. is cliche, and I have no idea if it's accurate since I live in New York City. But she goes through a pretty dark arc, but I'm not sure was really there prior to them filming the fireplace scene, but it's interesting. She uses the pterodactyl sword. She feels bad for ruining a girl's life in front of her parents. They don't show that photo or the parents or the girl, so it's a bit detached. I also feel like they could have milked the arc a little bit more. She wanted to run away, which... the acting was good. I don't know if it was great, but I don't know. I wasn't really a fan of the actress. I don't feel like... well, one thing, both Kimberlys have this weird territory. Attractive, but not like gold diggery, supermodel, trashy, B-word, attractive. As I would picture Sweet Valley High girls. And I guess they want to play safe by have Kimberly be a good role model, still be good. But then again, she did share the photo and ruin someone's, not to mention family's, life. Good job on writing her, though, Lionsgate.